So anybody here feel like you can't concentrate, like you have brain fog? Anybody like that?
Every day, right? Yes.
And it happened literally about 30 minutes before you got here, and it got real bad. Anybody like that? Brain fog? No? Okay. You? Yeah.
A couple of them. Okay.
You in the red. So just stand up where you are, the ones that feel like that. We're just gonna come around and we're gonna pray for them. If you're standing
Thank
around
you,
them, please just lay hands on them. Nicely. Don't be mean.
Thank you, Lord.
Father, we just thank you, God. We thank you that you are so aware of us and we are aware of you. And God, we just command all brain fog to go right now in Jesus' name. And we declare the clarity of our Father over our mind. I bind these minds to the mind of Christ, and we loose them into the clarity of Jesus Christ right now in Jesus' name. And Father, we just thank you. We just release healing. We release heaven right now. God, we thank you. Clarity of mind. Clarity of mind. Clarity of mind. Clarity of mind. No more whirling dervishes. No more spinning around the head. All that gone in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. How do you feel? How do you feel? Anybody better? No? Better? Yes? Stacy's about to fall out. How about you, Damon? You're feeling better? Amen. Amen. Stacy, can you? Yeah, better. Good. Alan? Did it move? Do you feel like sometimes you... So it's hot. It's good. Yeah. Well, God, more. We just say more, God. More, more, more. More, 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 Father. More. More. Into the joints. Into the bones, God. All the way down. All the way, in Jesus' name, all the way, more, 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 God. Wreck us in your presence, oh God. We need more of you, Father. More, 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 more. Guys, I really feel like this is something for worship. This is your worship should change. Clarity of mind changes worship. It changes worship. It changes worship. The mind of Christ is always about the worship of the King.
Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for what you're doing. Amen. So those of you receiving ministry, just keep receiving all morning. God's very present. We come together believing that he's going to touch us. Amen. And so, yes, ma'am.
I was going to say, during worship today, I saw...
Wait for the mic.
during worship, I saw a picture of an operating room. And there was a table laid out with all these instruments, and I knew surgery was going to be taking
Hallelujah.
Place. And I felt like today God was going to bring healing.
Amen.
He's going to do physical healing, heart healing, even
Amen.
From the issues of life. And he's good. He's
Amen.
Good. He's full of mercy. He's full of life. And when Amen. He comes, he does a good job. And I just felt like today's service
Amen.
Was going to be
Amen.
A little bit of that.
Hallelujah. No pressure for my sermon. I feel none. Right? Hallelujah. Amen. We're going to take an offering in just a moment. And as you prepare to do that, again, you can make checks payable to Global Harvest Church. You can give online at globalharvestchurch.co. If you do want to give cash giving, raise your hand. We'll make sure that someone gets you an envelope so you can keep track of your giving for tax purposes for the next year. Amen. And those are good things if you get a tax deduction. Amen. But it means you have to give a lot, so we're okay with that. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, what we do here is when we take an offering, we make an offering declaration, and we just bring that to the front as an act of worship and obedience and put it in the chest. So let's all stand together, and let's make this offering declaration over our house, your house, and our lives today. Amen. Heaven open. Earth invaded, storehouses unlocked, and miracles created. dreams and visions, angelic visitations, declaration, impartation, and divine manifestations, anointings, giftings, and calls, positions and promotions to go to the nations, souls and more souls from every generation, saved and set free, carrying kingdom revival. Thank you, Father, that as I join my value system to yours, you will shower favor, blessing, and increase upon me, so I have more than enough to co-labor with heaven to see Jesus get his full reward. Hallelujah. Amen. So let's bring those in faith. Thank you for your giving, your obedience. We're thankful to just the continued faithfulness and God's provision. Amen. In every area. God's good. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Praise God. All right. Hallelujah. At this time, we're going to dismiss kids, 6th grade and under, 12 and under, to go to children's church and nursery. And I know that I'm going to. Can you pick that up? Thanks. Hallelujah. And as they are going, I do want to make another announcement, okay, that this Saturday, and I'll have to check the times, but there is an all-day prayer and worship gathering where many churches and groups are coming together, of all places, at the American National Bank Operations Center, just north of Walmart. Now, we laugh at that, but after having done the burn for 2 years, it's kind of good to do these things at a neutral location, because some churches won't go to another church. Because we did that for 2 years, and it was amazing. Some of you guys remember the early days when we were burn directors here in Ardmore. Our team will be doing a set from 3:30 to 4:45, okay? And it's a come and go event. You can come and go all day if you want to come and be a part. I know that between the worship sets, there'll be time, about 15 minutes between those, of prayer, prophetic declarations, intercessions. We're praying over our city and our region. Amen. And so we'll be involved in that. I'm supposed to pray or do something after our team worships. I don't know. We'll see. We'll see what happens. But I know several churches are involved, and I think it's a good thing when we come together as a corporate body in a region and do those things together. Amen. And I know the 2 years that we were burn directors, and if you're not familiar with the burn is a mobile house of prayer. And once a month for 2 years, we met at different churches in the region. Some of you were here for those times. And it really was instrumental, I think, in bringing a shift in our region. And so I'm thankful that, you know, God's raising up people that have a heart to see that facilitated. So that'll be this Saturday. Again, our group from 3:30 to 4:45, and I think that last 15 minutes is me. I'll find out for sure. But you can come all day and all throughout the day if you want, and come and go. So let's be a part of that if you're able. Amen. And if you're not, that's cool. Pray where you are. Amen. It's at American National Bank, American Nation, I think. Their operations center, which used to be like Ryan's Steakhouse or something, by Murphy Express. Yeah, just right there, right south side of the bank there. So, all right, and I've posted that in the private group if you want to refer to that, which is, of course, Global Harvest Church and Christian School. If you aren't a part of that group and you're on Facebook and you want to be, just send me a request and I'll add you. We also have a public page that you can like as well. So I feel like I'm doing some public service announcements here. Right? Amen. So God's good. He's faithful. I'm excited about what he's doing. Praise God. Hallelujah. Now, this morning, I want to speak, and the last couple of weeks, we've been talking about, open heaven and what that looks like and what that means. And it's always interesting when you start talking about stuff like prayer. An answered prayer. How many of you like to get your prayers answered? Isn't it great when God answers a prayer? And, you know, it's really interesting because there are a lot of, and even just talking about the burn and what's happening next Saturday, there are a lot of prayer movements in the earth, which is a really, really good thing, amen. And God's restoring that understanding, you know, in this era that we're in of an outpouring of the Spirit. And, you know, if you've been around for a while in Christianity, you've seen a lot of prayer movements and methods. Everybody agree? Remember when Larry Lee in the 1980s was teaching on the Lord's Prayer and what a prayer movement that created? Some of you are like, I don't know who Larry Lee was, right? But some of you know, and that was a real movement centered around praying out of the Lord's Prayer. You know, if you've been a good Word of Faith person, you know about the prayer of faith, right? And if you know about the prayer of agreement, right? And these are all really good things. As I'm talking about these things, none of this is a criticism at all, because they're taking spiritual principles and teaching us how to pray. You know, praying in the Spirit, right? There's great value in praying in other tongues. And you know, this morning some of us gathered around 10 o'clock and we spent just a few moments praying over the service in the Spirit and in English, amen. And you know, we've learned about things like binding and loosing. Amen. Those are all really, really powerful things. We've got movements in the earth like the International House of Prayer, not pancakes. I know some of you like that too, right? But there in Kansas City in the 24/7 prayer movement, and you know, the Word of Faith movement, as I've already mentioned. And then you've got even a popular teaching right now on the courts of heaven, right? And everybody has their prayer niche, and they think that that's the only way to pray, which in reality, if we just pray, things change, right? And there's so many things and ways that we can pray. And sometimes I think God's just like, I just want you to interact with me, right? And I think one of the most valuable things that we can learn about prayer is that really the secret of prayer is friendship with God, right? Because we all want formulas, right? We want, say, well, just give me a list of how to pray, the structure, the verse, and I want to do it, when sometimes God is like, no, I'm just calling you to interact with me. And sometimes that's challenging, because sometimes we're not sure we want to interact with God. Sometimes we just want the formula when God really wants the relationship, right? And if you're going to have a friendship and a relationship with someone, it takes intentional effort and time. Husbands, has your wife ever preached that to you? Right? Well, if you really want to know me, right? When I tell my wife things like, well, you know, if you would tell me what you want, and she's like, you should just know. Y'all been there? That never works, does it? There's no scripture for that, right? But there is this reality of when you know someone, right, you know what they like, right? You know what's on their heart. You know when they walk into a room and they're in a bad mood. Right? You know, there's that reality of same way with not just husbands and wives, but what about friends? Right? Ladies, I think, are better at this. You know, they're like, oh, I got you this gift, and I know that you love this. Right? And because there's an element of friendship where there's been intentional knowing one another, spending time with one another. And you know, God really is the same way, right? He really is intentional about wanting to know us and have friendship with us. Now that scares us a little bit, because we've always thought of God as sometimes being really scary, right? And you know, he is a little bit scary, but when we know him, and we begin to experience him, we understand friendship. So I want to look this morning in John 15 as we begin. And one of my favorite verses of Scripture, verses 14 and 15 in John chapter 15. Jesus speaking to his disciples, and you know, this is a very famous discourse all throughout this passage in the book of John, where Jesus is about to go to be with the Father. He's about to leave the disciples, and he's giving them a last-minute insight into his heart and what they need for the next season. Amen. And he says in verse 14 of John chapter 15, "You are my friends if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you slaves, for the slave does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends, for all things that I've heard from my Father, I've made known to you." Wow, is that such a powerful passage where Jesus says, listen, boys, right? You've been living in this thing of servanthood and slavery, which, how many know, there's an element of servanthood that's good, right? It's kind of lost to much of this generation at this moment, even in the church, maybe especially in the church, where we've lost the value of servanthood, right? That's a posture of our heart. But Jesus is saying, you're not just servants or slaves anymore. You're friends. And I want you to know the heart of the Father, and I want you to know what he's thinking, and I want you to know what he's doing, and I'm giving you an invitation to experience him, right? Now, also, that doesn't discount obedience, right? Because there's this balance when we're talking about friendship with God, because sometimes we're like, well, I'm friends, I can do whatever I want. But Jesus said, you're my friends if you do what if you obey what I command you to do, okay? Which, again, is a real dynamic because, again, who gets more done? Aren't you willing to do more for a friend sometimes than your boss? Well, maybe you are, maybe you're not, because your boss pays you, right? But sometimes if your friend calls you and they really need you to help them move on a Saturday afternoon that is your day off, you're like, dang it. I wanted to go fishing, or I wanted to watch the game, or I don't know, I wanted to go throw axes somewhere. I don't know, right? Ladies fellowship. But because it's your friend, you'll give yourself to it, right? There's that element of friendship. So, you know, that really is the basis of what prayer looks like, okay? And, you know, Jesus gives us an invitation to know the Father as he knew the Father, right? And I think in this moment in history, God is calling. Now, every believer has this call. Right? Haven't you just been with people and you know that they've been with the Father? Right? Sometimes people come out of the presence of God and you know, there's sometimes I pick up certain guest speakers and, man, when I picked them up to bring them to the meetings, I know they've been with Jesus. Right? There's a presence and a glory on that because there's been this element of intimacy and friendship they have with the Father. Amen. And that is the key at this moment in history, for as the Lord's calling us as intercessors in the earth. Amen. Now, the Old Testament talks about several people that walked with God, right? And they all, I think, when you look at who they were and how they lived their life, they were intercessors. And their friendship with God changed history, right? And I'm not even talking in modern times when we could talk about people like Reese Howes and Heidi Baker and Bill Johnson and Evan Roberts and some of those people in present history and past history. But I'm talking about people like Abraham, Moses, David. They lived in relationship with God in a manner that was in the old covenant, right? And they lived in this realm that was almost like a New Testament reality because they pressed into an understanding, an awareness, a presence, and a friendship with God. Amen. And so, you know, first of all, let's talk about Abraham, right? And it says in James 2:23, and don't turn there, I'll just refer to it, but James said that Abraham was a friend of God, right? And he was a friend of God because he believed God. He trusted him. And you know, the interesting thing is that when God got ready to do certain things in the earth, he invited Abraham into a dialogue with him, right? When God got ready, and this is just crazy stuff, isn't it? But when God got ready to judge Sodom and Gomorrah, guess who he invited into dialogue with him? Abraham. And let's turn there. We're just going to refer to this a minute. But Genesis, let's turn to Genesis 18, verses 17 and 18, because I want to look at some of these principles. Genesis 18, beginning in verse 17. And the Lord said, shall I hide from Abraham what I am about to do? Now, have you heard the saying that God works in mysterious ways? Right? That's not really scriptural. I mean, in the book of Amos, the Lord said, it says, shall the Lord, basically the Lord wants to reveal to his prophets what he's doing. And how many of you know that God wants to bring you into dialogue with him? Right? There are times when God's wanting to move in nations, cities, and he speaks. And a lot of times, unfortunately, we don't know what to do with it. I remember hearing about before the Murrah building was bombed in 95 in Oklahoma, right? Up until that point, it was the worst terrorist attack in history until 9/11. But that there were certain intercessors that had visions of stuff happening. Same way with the World Trade Centers going down. They had visions of something happening to the World Trade Centers. And there was the Lord was inviting people in because he wanted to dialogue with them about what he wanted to do. Now, I don't always understand that. I just think, well, God, if you want to do something, why don't you just do it? But how do you know, how many of you know that God has limited himself sometimes to the prayers that we will pray? Now, we don't like that as humans because we just say, well, if God wants to do it, he's going to do it. And if it happens, it was the Lord's will. That's really a false doctrine, right? When God's looking for us to interact with him as humanity and change the destinies of nations, amen? And so here we are in Genesis, and the Lord says, shall I hide from Abraham what I am about to do? And Abraham will surely become a great, since Abraham will surely become a great and mighty nation, and in him all the nations of the earth will be blessed. And so the Lord begins to invite Abraham into this dialogue, and he says, you know, I'm getting ready. I've heard the cry from these cities and the immorality, and it's full, right? And I'm going to destroy. And what does Abraham do? He begins to say, wait a minute, God. What if there are only, you know, 100 or 50 or 10 righteous people in this city? Lord, are you still going to do it? And he says, if I find this many people, I won't do it, right? There's this invitation. Now, I know, you guys, this is a heavy subject. But our nation, right, is in a moment where we've got to cry out. And our nation and the nations of the earth are at a place when we must cry out to see what God intervene. Amen. And nations to come. And sometimes we get so focused on our lives. We get so focused on things like paying the rent, right? Or raising our kids, and those are important things that we have to take care of. But we forget there is a call to intercession for the people of God to change the earth, right? There's a call for us, and we're all intercessors. We're all prophets. We're all people that the Lord has called to hear his voice and enter into a dialogue with him. Amen. And so, you know, there's this debate that the Lord has with Abraham. And it's just amazing to me that God invited Abraham into that. Now, he also invited Moses into this type of dialogue with him. And it says in Exodus 33:11, it says that the Lord used to speak with Moses face to face, just as a man to his friend, right? Now, it's a crazy thing when you talk about that, because Moses was invited into the tent of meeting. And he would come out of those times, and his face was illuminated with the glory of God. You know, and the scripture talks about that glory is a fading glory, because he'd come out of the presence of God and it would fade away. But you do realize we're in a greater covenant in a different time where the glory on our lives doesn't have to fade, right? However, Moses would continue to go into the presence of God, and God would bring him into dialogue about what he wanted to do. Amen. And so there came a point where, you know, the people of God, they built a golden calf, right? You can read all about this in Exodus. And he built this golden calf. They built this golden calf, and God's like, I've had enough with you guys. You just keep disobeying. You just keep sinning. And he's like, Moses, I'm just gonna wipe them out. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad, like we were singing about today, that it's the kindness of God that just keeps chasing after us, right? I'm really thankful for the kindness of God and the grace of God. Now, I don't want to abuse that, right? But I'm thankful for his kindness. And so the Lord, he begins to dialogue. And I think sometimes God knew what he wanted to do, but he knew that if he invited people into intercession and prayer, that they would dialogue with him, right? Because he knew that there are certain prayers that needed to be prayed, amen? And so we see this in Exodus 33, and God basically just says, Moses, you know, I'm just going to wipe them out, and you and I can do this thing together, right? But Moses responds in intercession, and he begins to cry out, and he's like, God, if you do this, you know, it's going to affect your reputation. It's going to affect your name. It's going to put on your character that you made all these promises and they didn't come about. And so it's interesting to me how God responds. And I think it's just a crazy, crazy thing. And it messes with my theology a little bit. And I think I've lost it here in chapter 33, where basically it says the Lord changed his mind. Right? Wow. Is that a mind-blowing thought? That some of the things that are affecting nations at this moment, we can bring into manifestation the kingdom of God with our prayers? Right? Maybe if we didn't criticize certain things, but begin to release prayer and intercession and declaration, it would begin to change nations. Right? If we didn't say stuff like, oh, Carter County's the worst, isn't it? Whew. Ardmore, nobody knows how to drive in Ardmore. I've said it. I've experienced it. Or we're just never going to see a move of God in this city. Right? Are we partnering with the Lord in our declarations and what he's desiring? Right? When we first started the church over 11 years ago, that's hard to believe. You know, the Lord told us that we could rewrite the history of this city and this region. with what we declared and what we prayed and what we moved in. And that's a really scary thing. And so we just started to begin to declare prophetically, it's a new day in this city, in this region. And we started declaring that, and I mentioned the burn earlier, and we just started declaring things in the burn and prophetic declarations and all those things. And lo and behold, one day we saw the Daily Ardmoreite, which I don't ever really read, but I happened to pick it up one day, and you know what the headline on the Daily Ardmoreite was? It's a new day in Ardmore. And I was just like, oh God, our prayers and our intercessions are producing something. Amen. There's something that he's saying. Amen. And there's something that he's wanting to do in the earth. And he's looking for people that will partner with him in friendship, in prayer, in intercession, right? In cultivating relationship with him. You know, one of the reasons why worship is really important, private worship, but corporate worship, is because it really is about cultivating friendship with God, right? Have you ever been with a friend or family member, and you know that they're distant from you, right? Right? Husbands, wives, you ever get that, right? You know, sometimes we're so focused on our phones. Modern day dilemma. I was rebuked this week, rightly so, for being disconnected, right? And it wasn't even Jamie this time, right? This time. So one of my kids said, Dad, I've been trying to talk to you, and you didn't even hear me because you were on your phone. Yikes. Right? But aren't we that way with the Lord sometimes? When we're very disconnected, even when he's present? I mean, not only just on our phones, and that's a real issue in a service. Right? Or, you know, even sometimes, you ever been in a prayer time? And you're like, God, I'm just going to focus on your face. Bing. Oh. Instant message, text, right? Snap a chat, devil talk. and we can't even stay connected to the Lord because we're so consumed, right? We do it in our prayer time. We do it here. And again, I've confessed my sins to you, so I'm not judging you, right? Right? But sometimes we're so distant from him, and he's like, I just want to interact with you, right? I just want you to be present in these moments, right? And he'll speak to us. Sometimes there's so many voices that are being, you know, we're being inundated with and bombarded with, and he just wants to speak with us. And sometimes it's not just because he wants us to intercede and pray certain things, but sometimes it's just because he wants to know us, right? But sometimes it is because there are things that are on his heart. I had a dream a couple of nights ago. I'm still processing it. I don't even know what to do with it, but I think it's an intercession that the Lord's leading us into, and I'm like, God, this is so strange, but Lord, speak to me and show me. You're leading me in this direction, in this intercession. And God, what do I do with it? And isn't it crazy? I think sometimes God gives us dreams like that, or he gives us prophetic words, or he shows us things in Scripture, and he doesn't give us a full understanding just because he wants us to pursue him. And sometimes what we do is like, well, I don't get that, you know? I'm going to go binge Netflix, right? When the Lord shows us just enough that it's a call to pursue him. Ladies, don't raise your hands, but Did you like to be pursued by your husband before you got married? Mary's like, yes. I'm afraid to even say the second part. Do you still like to be pursued by your husband? Of course. Yeah. I mean, guys, I'm sorry. Right. You're gonna have to do better this week, right? Saturday at Brahms, they're thumping me in that little room, right? That means I really gotta be good this week, right? And but you know, we're made in the image of God. God likes to be pursued because it really is about relationship, right? And I think God really delights. Now, sometimes, let's be honest, coming to church, sometimes it's just faith. Sometimes it's just faithfulness, right? But isn't that part of relationship too? Right? And sometimes you're just like, God, I've got so much going on, and I need to do this, and I need to do this today. And sometimes it's just faithfulness to be present, right? Sometimes you got to fake it till you make it, right? But how much more when we come in His presence, there's a hunger. And there's a passion. Because you know what? The manifest presence of God really shows up where the people want it. Right? When there's an outcry and there's such a need and there's such a demand. Right? There's such a demand of God, we need your presence. God, we need a fresh outpouring. We need to see your face. Right? Now, when we're all doing that throughout the week on our own, how much more powerful is it when we all come together? Right? But God's looking for those that will host his presence, those where he can manifest, those he's present. He's present in every church this morning, all across the city, this region. There's a whole bunch of them. But he wants to reveal himself, and he wants to show up, right? And he wants to manifest who he is. And he so wants to move, and he so wants friendship. He'll do it in generally whatever tradition we've created. Isn't that funny? He'll show up here with us crazy Baptist charismatics. But he'll show up in the Eucharist at the Catholic Church too. Right? He'll even show up at the Church of Christ without instruments. Right? Because he wants to interact with his people. Right? But he'll show up where there's hunger, right? He'll show up where people are you know, but then there are those moments sometimes when, have you been with a really good friend where you don't have to talk, right? Right? Sometimes, I generally don't do this, but sometimes you can just go out and fish together and you don't have to say a whole lot. Or sit in a duck blind, which sounds miserable to me, but I've heard some people like it, right? I like to be sleeping, right? Oh, who am I kidding? I'm old. I can't sleep late anymore anyway, right? But sometimes even friendship, it's like I know who you are without even saying anything, right? And, you know, that's one of the things that, you know, I love about David, right? And David was a man after God's own heart. And there were things that because of David's friendship with God, that God allowed him to do that wasn't even technically legal, right? That happened often. Because, and even David was like, you know, God, I want to build you a house. And God's like, you know, you're not going to do that. I'm going to let your son do it. But you've been a man of war. He'll be the one who builds it. And then God allowed David to go ahead and do it. Why? Because of friendship. Because David loved the presence of God. And even when David messed up, and he, boy, did he mess up. But he kept getting back up and saying, God, I messed up. I've messed around. I've had people killed. But God, don't take your presence away from me. Whatever you do, God, don't take your presence away. I value you so much. Which shows me that sin is no excuse to stop pursuing God. It's a great reason to pursue God. Right? And say, Lord, I want to stay connected to your heart. And I want to stay connected to your presence. And God said, David, I'm going to let you do this. And David even set up a tabernacle in the Holy of Holies where a priest could only go once a year. And God allowed him to do it and set up worship 24/7. Right? It lasted 30 years. And God loved it so much, and he loved his friendship with David so much that he said in the book of Acts that he would restore the tabernacle of David in our time. Because God wants friendship, and he wants people that will pursue him and interact with him and dialogue with him. And God even allowed David to do things, and I don't understand it, and I don't know the theology of it, and I'm knee-deep in theology right now in my systematic theology class. Pray for me. Yeah, pray for Jamie. But God chose David. And there were certain things he allowed David to do, even though they weren't totally his plan. It's a crazy, crazy thought. Even we talked about Moses earlier. And there came a point when God was so fed up with the children of Israel, he said, you know, Moses, you guys go ahead and go into the land. I'm not going with you. But I'll send an angel. And he'll take you into the purpose and the destiny I have for you as a nation, but I won't be a part of it. Now, today in charismatic churches, we'd all be like, woo, there's an angel, woo. And I love angels. I've encountered some of them, and I love what they do. But you know what Moses said because he had friendship with God? He said, God, if you don't go with us, I'm not going. Which we can learn a valuable lesson from that. We have to love God more than we love our destiny. Sometimes we can get so focused on the destiny and the plan of God, and I think we should pursue destiny, and I think we should pursue God's plans. But sometimes we get so focused on those things that we miss God. When David said, I'll sacrifice everything, every plan, every prophetic word, if it means that I get to be with you. Man, did that move God? That is the key to relationship with God, right? That he's wanting to meet us. He's wanting to speak with us. Amen. Now, sometimes when you start preaching about something like this, it freaks people out a little bit. You know why? Because sometimes we've seen abuse, right? And we start talking about friendship, and sometimes people hear a word like this and they focus on the second half of the word, the ship, the vehicle that gets us there, instead of focusing on the first part of the word, which is friend, which is intimacy with the Father, which is intimacy with Jesus, the Godhead, the Holy Spirit, right? But, you know, think about it. When someone uses privileges without friendship, we violate the principles of relationship. Right? someone, if I invite a friend into my house, right, which is rare, right? I'm just kidding. But when I, no, I'm not really. Y'all can come sometime, right? But when I invite someone into my house, I give them access, right? They can go and raid my refrigerator if we have any food, right? Which is kind of doubtful sometimes, right? But if someone came into my house without an invitation and raided my refrigerator, what would we call them? It'd be a thief. They're outside of the privilege of relationship. And so, you know, sometimes we have to start with, you know, not just jumping in and saying, God, I'm your friend, and so you got to do this. Now, sometimes, I'm just going to make a stretch here. Sometimes I think God's so excited to hear from us that he does it anyway, right? Who all has had teenage children in here? Sometimes when they actually emerge from the bat cave and make a request, you're like, of course I'll do that for you. You communicated with me. Right? Mia's looking at me like, dude, stop. Right? I saw somebody post on Facebook that you should get a dog if you have teenage children just so you'll have someone glad to see you at home. Right? But sometimes we're so excited with relationship. I think sometimes it moves God when we begin to draw near to him, because what does the word say? That if we draw near to God, what does he do? He draws near to us. Because he's so hungry for relationship and friendship with us, right? And it doesn't take a lot, right? Sometimes it's the simplest prayers, I think, that have the biggest impact. Jesus prayed simple prayers. Demon, go. Right? Sickness, go. Extend your hand and you'll be healed. He gave simple prayers and simple commands. Now, sometimes I know that there's more involved in that, right? But sometimes we get so involved in all of our... And sometimes lengthy prayers are good. I've got confessions that I've prayed in seasons and declared the list that we had that had about 45 principalities that we'd go through and break. I'm not against that. I think there are times that you need to pray those things. But then there are those moments when you're like, God, I just ask you to manifest your presence because you're here. And Lord, I ask you to come. Lord, manifest your presence. And as you come, Lord, I pray that you break all the assignments of the enemy just through your presence. Right? We've seen that happen. One time years ago, we were in a service, and there was a person in the service that was opposing us, right? And as we were in that service, we saw the presence and the glory of God begin to come. And we said nothing to that person, and just as the presence of God began to come, by the end of that service, that person came up, and she wept, and she wept, and she wept in brokenness. Now, sadly, when she got out of the presence of God, she went back into what she'd been doing. But sometimes, as we see his presence and his glory manifest, what does praise do, according to the word? What does it silence? The enemy. He wants to manifest his glory. He wants to manifest his presence. He wants us to walk in friendship and relationship with him. Hallelujah. You have an invitation to know the Lord. Right? We've all had that invitation. I'd say most of us in here today are probably born again, and some of us know him very well. We're all on a journey of knowing him. We're all on this journey of experiencing Him and knowing Him, and we're all in these moments. Even as yesterday I was out walking my dog, and I just said to the Lord, Lord, I don't understand in this one area what You're saying to me, but God, reveal to me what You want to do. Reveal to me the prayers that You want me to pray. Show me the things that are on Your heart. Lord, I want to be a friend, right? When you've been with a friend, right? Or when you've been married to somebody for a long time, what starts happening? Some people aren't going to like this. You start acting and looking like one another. Martha does not like that. And Jim's not here today. He's still recovering, so don't tell him that she said that. Right? But doesn't that happen? You start looking and acting like one another. Right? What happens in our friendship with the Lord? Who He is, His glory, starts transforming us. Right? He starts taking us into a new realm of glory. We become aware of what's on His heart. Right? And sometimes you can walk into a room and you can know His heart without Him even saying anything. Right? Sometimes when God starts teaching us to move with Him, He has to do really powerful, Andy, this is what I want to do. You ever been there? Right? Where He gives a really, really strong word of knowledge or something. But then when you know Him more and you begin to walk into situations, you just know what He wants to do. Right? Sometimes when you know Him, you discern what He's wanting to do, and you even sometimes discern what the enemy's doing because you know Him. Right? And He walks with you. Right? We all have an invitation today to know Him more. Right? That doesn't mean we throw out formulas, but it does mean sometimes the formulas come alive. And sometimes it means the hard discipline that you've lived in, learning to play. What happens when you learn to play that instrument? Or you learn about art, or you learn about a certain sport, and suddenly the skill that you've been developing, it suddenly begins to click and it becomes to come alive, and you begin to flow in what you've been learning, right? What happens when the discipline of, oh God, I'm going to pray in tongues 15 minutes today, but my mind is about 100 miles away. Or I'm reading through my Bible this year, and Lord, I'm in Job right now, and I don't know that I'm going to get through it. Right? Y'all laugh because that's where I am. Right? But suddenly when you begin to walk in intimacy with Him, the discipline of that suddenly comes alive. And you're like, oh God, being here with You is the most wonderful thing I've ever experienced. Or that prayer that you've been praying for 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, right? Suddenly it changes, and what you've been praying for begins to happen. You're like, oh God, You're so faithful. He's calling us into intimacy. It's not a new call, but it's a renewed call, right? To know Him. And there are things, you know, I can talk about the intercessions. I can talk about the words that God's given us for a city, for a region, for a nation, for Oklahoma. Some of you guys have heard that 25 times, and you're like, don't preach it again, right? Sometimes I don't want to hear it again. But when he breathes on those things and it comes alive to us, we begin to move in it. So there's an invitation to know him today, right? So I want to challenge you throughout the week. And you might even just say, get in a quiet spot, just as simple as this, and say, Lord, I want to know you. Reveal yourself to me. Manifest your presence to me. Speak to me. Amen. He wants to know us. We can know him through his word. Amen. We can know him through his presence. But just move towards him. Amen. No matter where we are. Maybe you've only been walking with him a few days, a few months, a few weeks. Maybe you've been walking through with him for decades. The good news is there's always more. And there's always more that we can know of his presence and his glory. Let's stand together this morning. Father, I want to thank you today for your friendship. Father, there are things that we can all share together, but then there are things that you've reserved only between me and you. Same with everyone here. There are intimate things that you want to move and walk with all of us. And Father, we respond this morning to this call to intimacy and friendship. And Lord, I just thank you for the weight, the holy weight that's just been present all throughout this message. Because Lord, you're calling us. We feel the weighty call. And Father, it's such a kind invitation today to know you. And Lord, we just want to say yes to you. Well, Lord, we can only say yes individually. But Lord, I know today as a body of believers in this place, Lord, we say yes to you. God, there are prayers that you want prayed. There are declarations that you want made. Lord, speak to us. Reveal to us what's on your heart. Lord, there's such a glorious destiny for each one of our lives. But Lord, it has to totally revolve around you. And your presence, your word, obedience to you. Lord, teach us what it means to walk as a friend with you today. And it just takes time and intentional effort. And so, Lord, we give ourselves to the greatest thing that we can ever do. We give ourselves to the one thing of knowing you and experiencing you. So thank you today, Lord. Father, I just rebuke any lie of the enemy right now that says that we're not worthy to know you. Lord, you want to know us. Thank you for the invitation today, and we say yes in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Praise God. God's good. Amen. Experience him this week. Amen. Remember Saturday, if you want more information, I can give that to you, or you can look in the Global Harvest, and I'll put it on the public page as well. If you need prophetic ministry, if you need a word from the Lord, ask God for one. But you can also get prophetic ministry from our prophetic team today, which will be right here. If you still have further need of God to touch and heal you physically, I believe when we come together, he wants to touch us and he wants to heal. There will be a healing team here, and you can come and receive prayer from them. So, praise God. Remember, Supernatural School tomorrow night at 6:30, our final night of our School of Deliverance. And praise God. Have a good week and be blessed. Amen. Bless you guys.